premium hot air pop Pelican Bay white cheddar cheese popcorn.
That's beautiful. Say that one more time.
So, premium hot air popped Pelican Bay white cheddar cheese popcorn.
Welcome to the 11th episode of the Triplefour podcast. You've got me. My name is Dan, and my co-host.
Forgot my name.
Nicholas.
Hi, I'm Nick.
And today our special guest is Mr. Josh Zofel. Say hello to the people, Josh.
What's up, YouTube,
It's not even loud enough. Go ahead.
What's up, YouTube,
A little louder, one more time.
What's up, YouTube,
Not loud enough, but I will allow it for now. Who's got the best YouTube intro? Is it Custom Grow 420? Is it Report of the Week? Is it
Jablinski?
What's Jablin's Jables? That's what he says, right? That's what he says.
Yeah, I mean.
Well, hello, and welcome to another episode of Running on Empty Food Review.
See, I'm a review bra stan, so I can go ahead and say that's probably the best.
Noted.
I think it's the Triplefour podcast.
Oh, yeah, I gotta say, sup, foreheads. We established that in one of my videos recently. That my fans are known as the foreheads. So I think the main topic today is films. Have you heard of them? Have you seen them? They're not shot on film anymore, for the most part. Except for the one that we saw today. Me and Josh saw the new film from Quentin
Tarantino.
Quentin Tarantino. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Now, we haven't talked about this with Nick yet.
I have not seen the movie, and I don't want any spoilers, so this conversation is going to be limited.
So I'll give you the John Cherry explanation. I'll start at the end, and I'll work my way to the back, the front.
Awesome.
When he explained Fight Club to me at one point, I had seen Fight Club.
He's Tyler Durden.
So there's this guy who's like two guys, and if you haven't seen Fight Club, you've had like 20 years.
Oh, he blew up a building. Also, his name is Tyler Durden.
Alter ego is named Tyler. If you had to make up a cool alter ego, you'd give him a cooler name than Tyler, I think.
I mean, you got Tyler the Creator, Wolf Haley.
But I thought the whole point of Tyler the Creator was that Tyler was such an uncool name, I thought.
Yeah, I guess that's true.
So anyway.
Anyway.
Why won't you just be Bela? Or...
Bring that out. I mean,
what did you think of the movie, the film?
Josh, why don't you begin?
And if you give me one goddamn spoiler, that's
a mark on your permanent record.
That's gonna go on my driver's license. I'm gonna get pulled over by the police.
It's the first thing they're gonna see, and they're gonna be like, "Oh my god, he's a horrible person." Yeah. He gives movie spoilers.
We were at the first screening of the movie.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, we were.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well,
at 4
p.m.
this
afternoon in a very packed theater.
We're not giving out locations. I'm going to bleep it out. Nobody's allowed to know where
we are. Thought that you were going to have the theater all to yourself.
It wasn't packed.
No, it wasn't. Yeah, that was the whole bit. Yeah.
So we go to that theater in particular because nobody goes there.
Yeah. Okay.
Because at the other ones, the AMC and the local one,
that's where everybody goes.
Everybody goes there. Those are the more
popular.
The one we went to is not renovated yet. You know what I mean? Like, they don't have, like, the recliner chairs and shit. Yeah. I think that drives people away.
It's so odd, that location, because the way there's one entrance, there's no real entrance to it. It's like a side entrance that has no, like, actual proper, you know.
Yeah.
Sneak in the side door?
It like, looks like you're sneaking in from the back door, is essentially what
Well, you can
like.
Go in through the mall. But, if you just want to go to the movie theater, you can go through, and it's just a hallway with movie posters in it, and then you... Or in the theater. Anyway, there was like 8 people in the theater.
Sate?
Other than us. There was like Sate people.
There was around like two people behind us. There's a couple behind us. Then there's like four people. And then there's like an older couple in the bottom.
They were talking.
Yeah, the older people were talking the most, and they also had their phone out the most, which I also found.
No, there was like three dudes a few rows ahead of us who were Snapchatting.
And but there was the old couple, they had their phone on the brightness
of
their phone.
Oh, I couldn't see that.
Possible. And I legitimately looked down on them a couple times and said, are you serious?
And I'll tell you why.
Were they sitting in front of you?
They were further down, but I could still see the brightness, and it was as bright as the screen itself.
I saw when last movie we saw, there was a girl sitting in the front row of the theater with her phone out, taking Snapchats of the movie, and they were talking through the whole fucking movie.
Snapchat is the fucking worst.
I was so mad. Anyway.
Snapchat is always the thing that ruins stuff. You never see people like just scrolling through Facebook. It's always Snapchat, in my experience. Snapchat fucking sucks.
When you came to a movie theater to watch a movie and you're Snapchatting the movie, like...
Yeah, it's the one chance you have. Like, I can watch a movie at home and be into it and, like, pay attention.
Yeah, yeah.
As a reasonable person should.
Yes.
But I get that other people have grown up in the millennial, you know, monoculture or whatever, and they have to be on their phone or they're not doing anything at all. The theater is the one chance where you have every possible way of being engaged by the film.
The only reason I would pull my phone out in a theater is to check timestamp. Like, sometimes I'll look, like, if I'm not sure how long a movie is, I'll be like, look up the movie and see what the runtime is. But that's the only reason. If somebody texts me, I'm like, get fucked, I'm at the theater. I'm not...
Somebody texts me, I'll like, keep my phone in my pocket, but, like, bend it around.
Yeah, see, that's what I do. Yeah. Yeah.
But I won't respond.
No, I'll respond after the movie's done.
Yeah.
Yeah, or, you know, might be, like, movie.
So let me tell you why these people are on their phone.
Okay.
Because this movie is gonna piss off every normal viewer. Every regular viewer is going to be so upset with this. That is my thought. Again, we were in the first screening. This is my prediction. Because the people who are going to see a Tarantino movie... Tarantino's movies have been pretty available on Netflix. And I think there's a certain crowd who is probably now aware of Tarantino. I also went to film school. I can tell you that 90% of the people who went to film school did it because they saw Tarantino's movies. I think there's a very specific crowd who's attracted to his movies, and those people will be so let down by this movie.
Was it not good?
I'm not going to say that. I will say
it's not what I thought
it was going to be, for one. The marketing was so different from what the movie actually is.
Okay.
It is actually quite different from most of what Tarantino's movies are.
Charles Manson is in the movie, yes.
I don't... Not the if real I, Charles If I answer Manson, that question but... to the proper effect, you will be spoiled a little bit, I think.
Okay.
So I'm not going to...
But I mean, it has something to do with the Hollywood murders.
The Manson family is in it.
Okay, yeah. That's all I want to know.
Okay.
That's all you can really say without really giving anything.
That's all I get. Yeah.
Like...
Because the movie preys upon... Like, the movie is kind of predicated upon your expectations. A little bit. Which is a very common thing now. Like, to play movies against or with expectations. This movie manipulates what you think you're about to see quite a bit, I think. It's a very loose film. I listened to an interview with Tarantino today. And the way that he and the interviewer kept describing it as was a hangout movie. The guy said one of his questions was, Hateful Eight was probably your most plot-heavy film. Actually, Hateful Eight's the only one I haven't seen.
Really?
Yeah, I've seen all of the other ones. I've watched them multiple times, each of them.
Fun fact on the Hateful Eight, John Carpenter's The Thing was his primary influence for that movie.
It's also scored by Ennio Morricone.
Yeah. It literally has part of the score from The Thing, like, in there.
Hmm.
That's different shack, but that same shot where they're walking out to the shack and they got the tow line going through the snow, it's like the same exact shot from The Thing.
Hmm. That wouldn't surprise me. Although Tarantino has such an incredible Rolodex of references.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. This movie in particular showed that he is... I mean, I always knew he was so deep into 40s, 50s, 60s exploitation, grindhouse, B, C movies that... This one is in particular in, like, devotion to forgotten actors. That is a really big part of this. But yeah, very loose, very hangout, not a lot of stakes, very, very, like, floaty, like, rambling, ramshackling, like, what do you think, Josh?
Yeah, I would actually definitely agree with that. There's definitely parts of it where it's, like, where there's some things where it's, like, it seems like there's pressure on characters, but then in other parts it just doesn't, for the most part, it doesn't matter. And I think that's where that comes in with that floaty part. There is that definite theme of Americana 60s. And it's not heavily in the movie, as we discussed earlier, but I don't... Yeah, there's still, like, it's still there. It's still really prevalent. Like, the clothes that some of them wear, like the signs, of course, things like that. But it's not, like, driven into you. But overall, yeah, the movie, for me, it was something that I can't really put into words, and I never really, like, I don't think I really can. I'm not as much of, like, a movie person to, like...
Not so analytical.
Yeah, to, like, stuff like that. So I can't really speak from anything, and I'm not going to give out, you know, an opinion in which I don't have much, you know, of, like, an analytical role in part of. But, yeah, it's a movie that in which I can just say it is floaty, like what you said. But there is some pressure on characters at some parts. But for me, it sometimes just, it kind of... goes away in yeah. some weird thing, in some weird aspect, it just kind of just leaves. But yeah, I enjoyed it, but wasn't the biggest fan.
Do you agree with me that you think most people are going to be like, fuck this? Because
like with the average like Netflix yeah. point, probably. I think I like a lot of people are probably gonna expect like maybe the more plot heavy.
Because you know what?
Like, sounds like a great plug for the movie.
It wasn't yeah, seriously. It wasn't stylized
no.
as much no. as his normal films. You know, like there was a lot of postmodern like treading over like lines, you know, the integration of the film that is being made within the movie. Or, like, the TV show,
yeah,
rather.
Yeah,
like, the TV show yeah. that's being made in the movie just becomes a part of the movie.
Yeah.
And it kind of crosses lots of boundaries and, like, transcends stuff. So there's, like, some interesting experimental, like, moments and stuff. But, like, overall, it's not very stylish. It is very, very, like, wide-angle characters having dialogue.
Yeah.
And the scenes are yeah. very long. And, like, it's really just, like, you have to... like the characters, which the characters are good, I think. Yeah. Like, you're like kind of like, what's this guy about? Like, what's his deal? I mean, like, it's pretty obvious what Leonardo DiCaprio's, like, thing is in the movie, but the other ones, you're like, whoa, like, what's going on? What is Brad Pitt, like...
Yeah, Brad Pitt's character.
Yeah, Brad Pitt. Know, Brad like... Pitt's the best character, I think, because he was like, what's this guy's deal?
Yeah.
Like, and you, like, start to learn more about him a little bit, and you're like, whoa, what the fuck?
Well, because in Leo's character, meaning you kind of already knew what he was, and then... Cliff's character is more of a mystery to you, but as you go on, you find out a little bit more about his character.
Yeah. But yeah, I know you said, Nick, that you didn't think you were going to see this in theaters. I would actually say see it in theaters because it is going to be harder to watch outside of a theater. Like, I think it'll demand your attention more in the theater, and that is kind of a necessity. I think I will have to watch it again before I decide if it's actually good or bad. But I thought that it is... I thought it was kind of weak on the first viewing. So,
Not a great review.
Not a great review. But I'm kind of a Tarantino skeptic.
But that
gives
me... That lowers my expectations. So maybe I'll walk in thinking, you know... this isn't going to be so great, and then I'll walk out and be like, you know what, that was better than I thought it was going to be.
There's three main characters, really, and I didn't like one of the stories of the three. So that was all I'll say.
But we can move on, so yeah. Go ahead.
So, but that is kind of a segue into our next topic, which is Midsommar.
Mm-hmm. Which we've all seen. And we will spoil.
So. Hype, yeah, well, absolute spoilers coming up ahead. If you have not seen it...
You've had a month.
Beware, you've had a month. Come on.
Yeah.
Summer solstice. At this
point, you know what? I'll give you a Midsommar spoilers image. So once it's over, I'll put it. It'll be on the screen.
Okay, word. That's on the other end of the spectrum where the movie was hyped up so much, and after everybody saw Hereditary and moving into that, the marketing around it was great. I was even, you know, Ari Aster himself said that A24 has a phenomenal marketing team. And they were just really good about
A24 has been amazing because they know how to
Good production company.
I'll watch anything A24 makes. Same. That's how good they are. Same. Which, like, you can't say that about any other studio.
No.
Or distribution company. Like, that's what's kind of amazing.
Not to that extent, yeah. I've pretty, for the most part, I've loved everything that I've seen from A24. But it, just the hype around that movie. You know, a lot of people were walking in expecting something on par with Hereditary. Which, not saying it wasn't, but it was entirely different. It was not what I was expecting.
Yeah.
Much to the effect of Once Upon a Time. Like, it was not what I was expecting in a big way. But I really enjoyed it. You know, whenever the credits hit and the movie was over, I was kind of like, what just happened? It took a good couple days for me to kind of process and be like, you know what? I liked that movie.
See, I liked Midsommar more than Hereditary. I'll come out and say that. I actually didn't think that Midsommar was as unexpected as... But, like, I also... I don't know. I wasn't, like, surprised by as much in Midsommar. Except for the key scene, which I'm describing the cliff scene.
I don't think that was the key. Yeah. I was thrown off by the intro.
With the family.
Yeah.
And like, I was like, whoa.
I thought that was Ari Aster being like, this is what I'm fucking about, dude. You want some fucked up family stuff?
Like, it was pretty obvious going into it that, you know, the sister was involved, but when they made the other reveal, I was like, oh, fuck.
Well, they kind of did this thing where they did, with the boyfriend and the main actor, they were kind of having, like, he was being distant with her and with stuff like that. So I was like, oh, it's more, like, relational issues. And then they dealt with the family. I was like, oh, this is, like, more even, like, even more dark, even more, like, horrific.
Yeah.
So he really, like, went.
But just
like,
that, in the intro, like, once they get through that and the open, like, the shot of them going through the house.
Yeah.
And then
yeah.
looking in the different rooms, I was like, oh, my God, this is gonna be real fucking dark.
Well, I think...
Which it's not. It's actually a very bright movie.
Yeah, well...
Literally, except for, speaking, beginning, but, yeah.
Well, I thought during that first part, which actually all takes place before the credits start.
Right.
Which is cool.
And that's what... Yeah. I knew as soon as they did it, too, it was one of those... I felt good about it, because I'm like, I understand the medium kind of thing.
Yeah.
Like, they did that, and the snowstorm comes in, and it says Midsommar, and, like, right, I was waiting for it. And I knew they were going to go, like, right bright to summer.
Yeah.
Like, I knew they were going to do it, and I literally, like, on the mark. I snapped in the theater. Yeah. I was like, here we go.
You were like...
Yeah.
good reference.
They talked... No, he's talked a lot about that in interviews. Like, they asked him... That's a funny thing that you mentioned that... I guess that's not really mentioned, but... They asked it's him and the two kid actors from Hereditary, and they're like, if you could describe this film as a sound, how would you describe it? And they all, at the same time, they all go.
By kid actors, you mean like the boy and
the
little girl?
Son and the daughter.
When I was in that, the whole part before the credits, I was definitely thinking, this dude is making a fucking statement. Like, this is what I'm about. Like, because Hereditary was such, like, a grief movie. Such a, like, depressing, like, traumatic film. And I felt like when he was doing that opening, he was like, I'm not fucking around, dude. My movies are about some real shit. And I was like...
Dude, everything so far that I've seen, he's got a really good way of conveying... Maybe it's not the clearest and it's up for interpretation, but that's the thing, is it makes you ask questions, but he's good at getting some kind of message thought... Like, he wants to make you think about it, you know?
Yeah. Well, I was trying to figure out, after we left Midsommar, I was trying to figure out, like, what was he saying with this one? Because in Hereditary, I felt like it was kind of obvious.
Oh, that first night I was absolutely fucked after Midsommar. I had no idea what to think about it.
Well,
we sat there in the parking lot and talked about it, and some people pointed out some things that I missed, but...
Not what to think about it, like, well, if you liked it. I'm just saying what it was about.
Right.
Because with Hereditary...
Well, that's what I'm saying, is taking away... What was that about?
Yeah.
You know? Yeah.
So, with Hereditary, I thought it was fairly obvious that it was about, like, trauma or mental illness being passed through generations. The title Hereditary makes that kind of clear. Mm-hmm. Like, and she's talking, and it's about her grandma, or the Toni Collette's mom, the grandma,
right.
dying, and then, and her talking about that really great fucking scene where she's in, like, that group circle.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah, and she's, like, talking. Yeah, I know, and she's, like, talking about, like, you know, her fucked up past, and then it, like, her own children are now experiencing this, and ghosts are a very good metaphor of trauma being passed down or history. And so I thought that was kind of obvious. I mean, just for me as a horror movie fan.
And that's what Ari said. He said he wrote it originally. When he wrote the screenplay, he wrote it as a family drama. The horror elements came in afterwards. He didn't pitch it as a horror movie.
Huh, that's interesting.
That's what he wanted. He wanted to write a family drama. And then going into that, he was like, I had to ask myself, you know, assess what am I afraid of? What are my fears? And it had a lot to do with abandonment and loss of a family member and grief and, like, these very real, heavy things that are terrifying.
Yeah. I just realized, Josh, you haven't seen Hereditary.
No.
Okay.
No. Damn it.
Well, we haven't spoiled anything.
Without knowing that he hasn't seen it, I didn't really spoil anything.
I know. Well, that's why I didn't. Nothing of what you said sounded like spoiling. But no, I mean, it's perfectly fine. It definitely, I'm sure that connects to the two in its own ways.
And that's what a lot of people.
And that's what I was going to say. Like, to bring to the point of, like, what it is about, and I think it was, like, finding, for me, I guess,
Midsommar.
Midsommar. Yeah. So I think for Midsommar.
So you've seen Midsommar?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, and.
That's interesting. That's the most people
have seen.
Most people probably seen Hereditary set in Midsommar. Yeah. To me, what it was about, and I guess this is where we kind of can dive into the spoilers a little bit, was the fact of having new life in something that you've had taken away from you. So it's finding new family in which to replace the old in which you have, or it's finding something new to, to just basically replace what you've had before. I'm repeating myself.
So,
but
like a replenishing.
You're talking about.
Like, so with the whole family member incident and how then she went to the camp and found that camp is basically in her family is kind of where I think of.
Okay.
It's a replacement of family. And then they kind of led to that a little bit. It might be just, you know, a just basic,
no, that's,
like.
That's actually really reasonable. I like that.
No, that's where I kind of got out of it, and then also, it's also fine. It's the replacement of love as well, based on, you know, earlier how the boyfriend was distant in the beginning, and you can clearly tell he was distant just by his tone of voice, and by, you know, the words he was using.
Well, yeah, and the way he's talking to his friends
too.
And they're all like, "Oh, we."
Basically, he was basically wanting to fuck chicks there.
All been
there,
in that position where somebody,
like,
was dating somebody and you're with your boys.
Yeah.
And like, man, what are you, like...
Yeah.
And even to announce that she's coming over and...
They're
the
all...
Collective groaning of, like, oh, fuck.
So it's
like,
just that, and then when...
That's what tonight's gonna be, like...
Then the Swedish guy kind of steps in as, like, the new love
he's
interest.
Very
yeah,
Swedish
he's
guy was classic, though. He was just, like...
He's just he's a classic, like, foreign student, though.
He's
beginning.
Really nice, but turns out he's got some fucked up shit going on
back
home.
Shit going on. Can we talk about the hallucinogens, though?
There's a lot.
The effects of that.
Yeah,
I thought
that
was
a
really,
a
really cool device within the film, and it really reminded me a lot of Mandy.
Okay.
But on a brighter spectrum. Different hallucinogens, different environment, you know, because Mandy is, like, the fucking grindhouse, very dark and...
It reminded me of Donnie Darko. If you remember, have you seen Donnie Darko?
Yeah, of course.
Have you seen Donnie Darko?
No.
Oh,
what?
Well,
you
have to leave.
Okay.
At this point, I should be.
You got
it.
At this point, I'm just going to be uninvited to the podcast.
Again, this podcast is brought to you by
Premium hot Pelican air Bay popped Pelican Bay white cheddar cheese popcorn.
Pelican Bay.
One more time.
All right, one more time. The premium hot air popped Pelican Bay white cheddar cheese popcorn.
Pelican Bay.
Anyway,
it reminded let me finish the Donnie Darko thing.
Yeah,
real quick.
Yeah.
It reminded me of Donnie Darko when he's like, he can see the time spheres things that are coming out of people's chests.
Yeah,
and then
yeah.
There's this part where they're at the party and he looks into the tube and his eyes go all like googly eye. You know what I'm talking about? Like his eyes start bulging out. Like
in Donnie Darko?
Yeah, in Donnie Darko. That's what it reminded me of. Because there was like that swirly, bulgy, like effect.
The roses on her head, if you remember, they do that. They get in and out.
Well, their eyes then, pop big. And
well, that's a they real do that thing. As well.
Like, if you were. Ever done mushrooms, it's very pulsating.
It's also like the meat on the
any
table
kind of radial
like
thing you see if you're like deep in it, you get that pulsation.
Well, it's also like if you see the meat on the table in that dinner scene, it's also like swivelly too.
Yeah, no, everything.
So it's like everything.
Trees,
yeah, everything
trees,
was
grass,
moving. Yeah,
I love that first part when they get to the festival and she looks down and the grass is like growing
through her hand. Yeah, that's cool. that's really cool.
And you got dude from, I don't know the actor's name, the guy from We Are the Millers that's doing the whole thing.
Eyebrows.
There's a new person. There's a new person coming. I don't like new people.
That's why family always references him as eyebrows.
Lay down. Everybody lay down.
He was funny. Yeah, throughout it.
That was really the only comic relief.
The part of it that me and Dan joked about afterwards is he brought his vape on set. And we think that it was just... He just brought it on set. They didn't really realize it until it's too late. They're like, "Oh, whatever, it's on set anyway."
I saw that going so much.
Will Poulter.
Oh, okay,
is the actor's name. I saw that going so much worse. This is like real spoiler here, kind of. When they first get to the festival, and she's still a little uncomfortable. She's not sure that she wants to be here, and immediately. Dude comes up. He's like, "Oh, you guys got here just in time. We just took some mushrooms. We got some for you too."
Yeah.
And they go, and all the guys are ready to do it, and they're like, "All right, let's do this." And she's like, "Well, I think I'm gonna wait a little bit." And they're like, "No, that's gonna fuck up the whole thing. You got to take them now." And she's like, "Well, I don't know." And then she's like, "You know what? It's fine. I'll just take them."
See,
I thought that was gonna go so fucking far south, and that's. I mean, again, that's the kind of stuff that Ari does. It's twisted to where you think you're going to go one way, and then it's...
Well, linking it back to what the movie was about, I feel like, for me, I was really honed in on the relationship between the main girl, Florence Pugh, and the guy, the discount Chris Pratt, is what some people called him.
Chubby discount Chris
I think his name is Jack Rayner.
Okay.
The relationship there was what I was really honing in on, and like how she evolves through the movie, especially with the ending, because the ending is like her like gloriously dancing in the fire of which he is dying.
Yeah.
Like,
which, what a fucking shot, dude.
Yeah.
That whole last.
His whole, him and the bear.
It was
suit.
A really beautiful movie. The imagery is fucking
gorgeous. I love that.
And can I just say that, first off, the second that I saw the mural, or the fucking, like, the painting where they pan over and show, like, the prophecy, I'd have been like, I'm out. I am fucking out.
Yeah. Well, there's a lot of that foreshadowing. Like, every few scenes, they show you a piece of what's just to come.
Right. Yeah, there's the one classic one I saw was when Jack's character was in that little hut, and he was looking at the wall, and he saw the bear being lit on fire in that little cabin. I was like, oh, that's something.
Huh, crazy. I wonder if that'll...
Well, what happened there?
I need to
when
watch
he was
again.
In, like,
I knew it was one that I'm definitely like gonna watch again. But there were some things that people pointed out that I didn't catch before. What was up with the fucking scissors under the baby's pillow? Anyone?
The
baby's pillow.
There was. You remember they had the baby in like the main building where everybody was sleeping.
And it was
just crying every night. Which, by the way, again, I'm out.
There
was one. It was so subtle, and like not everybody caught it. But it was something that, and they. I don't think they ever explained it. There's one scene where somebody walks up and they put a pair of scissors under the baby's pillow.
Huh.
Never heard anything else about it. They never referenced this baby again.
Oh, I don't remember that.
Yeah,
and it was just something that I saw and I was like, what was that about?
There's a lot of details. I mean, it was a very, like, dreadful, like, weird, mysterious movie.
Yeah.
I was just sucked in. You know, like, absolutely. Everybody I've heard complain about it, which I've heard a couple people, like, it's a pretty divisive film.
Yeah.
Everybody I've heard complain about it is just like, man, it was so boring. I knew they were going to get killed. And no, like, well, what the Well, I mean, it's a horror movie, and it's people going to a place they don't understand, and there's different, like, it's no different than going to Blood Lake. You know, it's not any, like, it's like, but that's not why you watch horror movies. You don't watch a horror movie because, like, I wonder if these campers will get butchered by a hockey mask guy. Like, you don't watch it, like, if, but this movie still had mystery, because you were like, what's gonna happen?
This is the new generation of horror, and this is the stuff that I like, that this is why I love Ari as a director. He's so good at misleading you, at taking you in a direction, thinking that one thing's gonna happen, and that it's just like, I have no idea what the fuck's going on right now.
Yeah,
and it's not like an M. Night Shyamalan kind of, like, what a twist. It's like, you're engaged the whole time.
Because I hate that, too.
Yeah.
You're engaged the whole time. It's not just a thing at the end where it's like, oh, it was really this, and you're like, oh, fuck. Like, no, it's engaging the whole time, and you're like, what is happening? And you follow it all the way up to a point where whatever it is happens, and you're like, I'm not still really sure what just happened.
What were you gonna say, Josh?
I was saying, like, the whole contrast between this, the gruesomeness of, like, deaths and that, and the whole beautiful, like, landscape and that whole bright and colorful.
Oh, it's gorgeous.
Was something I really loved. I love the imagery of this movie, like the whole atmosphere of the whole, like, cabins, this outside the lake.
The paintings, the flowers.
Yeah, the paintings, even like just everything was so beautifully well
even
done.
Like the white gowns.
It makes just, like, the white gowns, especially, and, like, the crown that's, it's everything like that was so beautifully, like, detailed in this, like, design, and then was just the gruesome, like, deaths.
And that fucking, what do you call it's not a hut, it's, like, the fucking
pyramid.
Chapel,
yeah,
like, the pyramid thing.
It's just, like, it seems so serene, and then once you get in those deaths and stuff like that, it's, like, it's so contrasting that it just really...
To the themes
the
subject matter.
Yeah, it's just everything was so contrasting. It was just like such a crazy experience for me, and that's something I really appreciate about it. And I really, I really dig that. But I wanted to talk about it, but this, the whole cliff scene. Right. I wanted to talk about it.
And that's when all of them realize that they're like
the horror.
Whoa,
of
what
it.
Are we
yeah.
doing here?
Yeah, like,
what are we doing here? Which I would have realized way earlier, but...
Well, I feel like we haven't resolved some things that we've talked about, and we keep moving on. Let me just get out, like, I wanted to really address, again, what the film was about, because I haven't really talked about it. I was thinking, and Ari Aster has since, in interviews, talked about it, that he thought, like, that the film was about a relationship, or a toxic relationship. I definitely got that from it, you know, like, because I was, but, like, what was compelling was, like, you, at least for me, as a male, I kept thinking, like, who's actually to blame, or, like, who's in the wrong here, because...
Within the relationship?
Yeah, because at the beginning, it was like, yeah, her family fucking suicided, which is a real term. No. Her family got blown out. And and then he was like, what, he can't just leave her, you know? Like, he can't just, like, break up with her and be like, fucking deal with it, you know? Like, that's a situation
I think we've all kind of been in a similar...
Not that I've dated somebody whose family fucking killed themselves.
Suicided.
You know, but, like, I was in a relationship...
Yeah, where something bad happens and they're in the pits and you don't want to
like,
just leave them while they're down. Like, you don't
want
to kick them while they're down.
You
don't
you want to break up with somebody, but you can't do it because, like, you're like, how fucking bad is this going to be?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Like, and, like, that's why I can't blame the guy at the beginning, you know? Because he sticks with her, right? And then they get older, even though he wants to break up with her. And then they get... 6 months. It's 6 months later, and he's drifting from her. Obviously, and it's like, but like, how does he do that? You know, like, that's a real challenge, I think, and like, it makes you it makes the drama complex.
That's a real scary thing in real life.
Yeah.
Again, Ari, with the fucking
true
dread.
Yeah, real grief.
Real
drama.
Real dread in
real
life.
Trauma.
Like,
yeah.
People have been in that situation know that that is a terrifying scenario to be in. Like, how do I break up with this person?
Yeah. But he definitely, but the boyfriend definitely makes a lot of bad choices along the way. Oh. And you're like, okay, dude. Like, yeah. like, I think for a lot of people, like, the scene at the cliff where those people jump off and die and they get hammered, which is the fucking craziest scene.
Oh, and then the sun explodes and the movie's over.
Yeah, spoilers.
Midsummer.
Summer's over. Sun's gone.
Sun's exploding.
But, like, yeah, it... I thought like it was definitely about her ridding herself of this relationship, and at the end he's burning alive and she's enjoying it, and I think there was like sort of this great super dramatic weird catharsis to it, because I thought Red Letter Media or whatever made the comment that she was like frowning the whole second half of the movie. By the point where she's May Queen, she's just like going along with everything. But, like, at the end, she's definitely smiling when that destruction is going on. And it's, like, I feel like it was, like, this self-revelation.
Cathartic.
Yeah, it was, mm-hmm. like, she's realizing that she was in a bad relationship or whatever. It's a fucking elevated version of that, but it is, that's what's going on. Yeah.
Far beyond elevated.
Yeah, so it's like a relationship movie surrounded by a slasher. That's what I felt like.
Did you see, am I tripping, or did they have a human body on the dinner table at one point?
I think that's what we were talking about with the meat.
Yeah, there was, like, some mystery meat in there.
I think it was one of the bodies, because remember they burned the bodies of the, or they put
them
on
could
the,
have been,
on the pyre.
It could have been Will's character, because they never explicitly had his body in that cabin.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
There's a few in there.
I thought his body was one of the bodies in the pyramid at the end, because they needed so many sacrifices.
Wait, is Will the one that was snooping?
He's the vapor. Well, he went off with that girl.
Yeah.
And then was never seen again.
Okay.
Well, and then
okay.
That one scene where who was the...
Well, because I know his counterpart, the guy that was doing his thesis on...
Yeah, that guy's character was in there.
He was snooping in the building he wasn't supposed to be in, and they fucking...
Well, the guy who was hit him was wearing Will's face, and
I couldn't tell. Remember, we were talking about that. Like, we couldn't tell if it was his face or not.
It was also it was someone's face, and it was also someone's penis, it seemed like, because there was a red blotch on his crotch area. So there's also something there, too.
It was weird.
Yeah, it was very sudden.
Did you guys catch when she goes in the outhouse towards the beginning of the movie, and they flash the figure in the mirror?
Oh, yes. Yeah, I do remember that. If she was looking at the mirror and then someone was behind her, like an older woman?
Do you know who it was?
I can't remember.
Somebody told me and I didn't realize it, but I watched it again. I saw the clip of it and I was like, oh, fuck.
Yeah, I do remember
that. That's a bad trip.
And then she went out again and it...
I saw that.
I was like, oh.
Okay, yeah. Then
I saw that.
Yeah, okay.
Still don't know what's up with the scissors and the baby thing, but...
Anyway, I thought it was a good-ass movie.
I love the movie.
I thought it was funny we got out of there, and one of my buddies was like, I hated it. I'm like,
right?
And this dude said a similar thing about another movie that I thought was great. And I was like, okay, well, you just don't know anything about movies, so...
Well, I had a long argument with one of my friends about it. Because, like, a few days after we saw it, we went and hung out with a bunch of friends, and two of them had seen it that day. And one of them was like, it was fucking stupid. It was so boring. All the characters made the stupidest choices, and like the reasonings for his like opinions were so malinformed, you know, because it was always like, okay, so like one of the shots in the movie that stuck with me was like when they're entering the camp. There's the like camera like turns upside down.
Oh, and they're going down the road.
I thought that was brilliant.
That was great.
That was dope.
Because it's like it's totally setting you off guard. Right,
it's trying to disorient.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you're like, oh fuck, what's going on? Yeah. And like, you're like, it's a very strong symbol of this shit's not right.
To flip you over.
Yeah, and so he was like, they only did that so they could show off how that they could or some shit. And I'm like, you're watching the movie with a completely wrong mindset.
Right.
Because it's like, if you don't respect the art, you won't care at all about anything. You'll be like, because you could say it about fucking anything. Like,
literally,
they only show the Terminator because they have the effects to do it. It's like, that's not a thing. They made the movie because it's about a Terminator. I don't know. Like it's just the fucking stupidest argument because...
Anyway, we're here to assess the Terminator.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, I don't know. There's so many dumbass arguments that, like... For me, it is kind of hard to explain with Midsommar for me because
I walked out, I had no idea what to think. It literally took me a good couple, I'd say at least 3 or 4 days before I went back in my mind and I was like, okay, I kind of see what was going on there.
See, but I like stuff that challenges me, especially because I have seen so many movies at this point. So if you can like make me feel like I don't know what I saw, then it's a fucking huge accomplishment. And it's not like that I didn't know what I saw, but I was thinking a lot about like, oh, man, what is he trying to say? What's he trying to do?
Yeah.
But it's because I have respect for the director. I have respect for the medium. I know that like they were doing something and they felt confident about it. And I can see in the craft of the film that he was doing something that whether I understood it or not, that it was being done successfully. And I knew that like, I was engaged by the film. I was so interested because, like, and another friend of mine who didn't like the movie, different guy, was saying, like, well, I kind of knew that they were going to get killed. I knew that it was going to... And I'm like, that again, that's... Yeah, you can't. That's not the point. For me, at least, the craft is, how does that happen? Is it interesting? Is it new? And, like, that cliff scene, like I said, is fucking insane. Like, that cliff scene is the... There's a scene in Hereditary that is equally shocking.
Oh, my.
If not way more.
Mouth agape, I cried.
Yeah.
I cried. My mouth was like jaw to the floor, sitting there just in complete dismay. That movie is absolutely harrowing if you have not seen it.
So now that I've gotten introduced to Astor's films, I want to now see that.
Yeah.
Well, in Hereditary, it was one of the fucking wildest experiences in the theater because I had never seen an entire theater audience just being absolutely wiped. Yeah, it was like... Because, you know, people are always on their phones, they're always talking
or something. I guess certain people... I judged it when I was in the theater because I was so, like, invested in it. Somebody laughed. And I was mad that they laughed, but I also recognized, like, I was watching an interview with Bill Hader on the new It movie the other day, and he was saying that there were a lot of scenes where, you know, Bill Skarsgård is really good at playing Pennywise, and he's actually fucking scary. But he's like, it's hard for me, this is my first
horror
film.
You're not going to convince me, but go on.
This is my first, my first horror film, and it's just natural, like, my...
Instinct is
to
laugh.
I'm not good at acting scared, so my instinct is to laugh.
Yeah.
You know, so I think that's... probably what was going on there.
They're so uncomfortable that they have to laugh.
Yeah.
Which I get.
Yeah.
But I don't know. Just shut up. I mean, if you're in a theater, like, just shut up. Like,
please?
But yeah, that scene, like, it's like, I could never have fucking predicted that was going to happen in Midsommar.
No.
Like,
no.
I knew wild shit was going to happen. I never thought it was going to be that.
Never saw that coming.
And the tone is weird in that scene, because it's not as like traumatic and like serious and grim as it is in Hereditary. That scene was more like, it was kind of funny in some way, like in Midsommar. Cliff scene, like, it was like vaguely funny because you're like, this is so extra.
Well, it's like the way he was, like the way that people were looking over the cliff and then the way they fell, and it's just like something that's not like
the gore that they show in that, like, when
it was intense.
It was a lot.
Shit,
dude. And yeah, that was something that I didn't expect at all, was how much gore was actually in there. But yeah, I can definitely see with a vaguely like humorous aspect comes in there. It's the way they fell, and it's something like that. It's like, you don't, it's not really appropriate
to
laugh.
It's the different reactions from the group too, from the people that are there as the outsiders.
Yeah.
It's like some of them are like, whoa!
Yeah.
The other ones are like,
I'm gonna go to the bathroom.
I'm going to go to the bathroom as well. Josh, this podcast is on you now.
All right, well, the gruesomeness of that film and just the whole aspect of the brightly colored settings, the cliff scene, yeah, again, I could see the humor in it. Me personally, I was a little bit shocked by it, of course. I mean, as a lot of people in the crowd were, of all of like the 8 people that were there, including me and Dan. So, but... other than that, I mean, I think Midsommar is really worth a watch. It is a divisive movie. But all in all, I think it was beautifully, like, shot. The characters, they are a little bit relatable in that sense. And I think it was just overall something that you should see. not, it's just to be, say if it's good or bad, but just as an experience alone, because the experience of the movie in itself is something that you can, that is worth watching.
Psych, you thought we both went to the bathroom. I'm still here, still got Pelican Bay Trading Company Hot Air Pop White Cheddar Cheese Popcorn. And that is the bottom line, what this podcast is brought to you by.
It is premium.
It's popcorn.
Hello.
Dan's back.
I don't... Who's Dan? My name is Marcus.
Better Tarantino.
Marcus. My name is Marcus Theater.
Hey, Marcus Theater. Welcome to the podcast. Marcus? How you doing?
I'm just great. I love movies. I like talking about them.
Okay, what'd you come here to talk about?
Wait, first off, would you like some Pelican Bay premium?
This is brought to you by Pelican Bay Air Pop premium popcorn. Hot popcorn.
Cheddar cheese.
Sure. This is something you're sponsored by?
Mmm. This is our sponsor for tonight. That's generally.
Takes a little bit of getting used to.
It's generally the reaction we get out of people.
Yeah. Well, you know.
That's great.
But once that hot air pops to the back of the glands there.
Oh, it is a tough one to swallow.
Anyway,
it's pretty good.
You doing some ASMR there?
I'm doing some hot air.
I own a
white cheddar ASMR. The kernels get really stuck in the throat.
That's really great. I might show that in one of my theaters.
You're Marcus Theater. Oh, you're that
I'm,
Marcus.
I'm Marcus
Theater.
Yeah.
I didn't recognize you.
Yeah. Well, I go by many faces. But the thing is, I own a chain of theaters. And you know, I show all kinds of different things. I might show an ASMR video. A white cheddar Pelican Bay popcorn themed ASMR video, maybe in a film festival. I have this film festival I put on, it's called Marcus Film Festival. But I just wanted to talk about a film I just recently showed. It's called Roar. Hmm. So, what's your name, sir?
Josh.
Josh. So here's the deal, Josh.
All right.
Now this is a film. It's special to me. It's close to my heart.
Yeah.
And that's because I'm a friend of the animals.
Right.
I love the animals, all of them. I love geckos. I like zebras. Mm-hmm. I like Charmanders. But you know,
You're a fan of the weasel.
Weasels are they're good. They're not my favorite.
Okay.
But you know, if there's one animal that I like the most, it'd be a lion. Have you heard of these lions?
You know, I've been passing a couple times around the block and around my local zoo. Yeah, I've seen a couple.
You've seen these. Okay, that's crazy. I got the film for you.
Oh, okay.
It's called Roar.
All right.
Here's the thing about Roar. So this guy, Noel Marshall.
Okay.
He liked lions also. He was kind of an important guy. He was a producer. He produced The Exorcist. That's real. That's true. And he was like, you know what the fuck? I'm gonna buy a lot of lions.
As we all want to.
Yeah, of course. Like I said, I'm a fan.
Yeah, I mean,
I'm a fan of the lions.
Why wouldn't you be?
Yeah. They're cuddly.
Yeah.
So he bought all these lions, and he was like, okay, well, I'm going to keep them at my house. And he had this house full of lions in Beverly Hills, and the police showed up, and they were like, hey, lions aren't allowed here. So eventually, they had to move all the lions to a nature reserve.
This is the actual synopsis of the movie?
Who are you?
Oh, hey, I'm just tuning in here. This is Nikki the Nose. I'm here representing Who Goes There. I was just curious about this film that you're talking about. It sounds real interesting. So this man has some lions in his house.
Yeah, he has all these lions in his house, and then the police showed up. They said, you have to move them. This is just real life. This is not in the movie. This is just real life.
Oh, this is an actual...
This is a real thing.
So this is the actual backstory, of this movie.
Yeah.
Oh, but this is in the movie.
Not in the movie.
This is not in the movie. This is the story of a movie about a man that this happened to.
So I guess this is, making of the movie.
It's, this is pre-production for the film. I love films.
Oh,
I
this actually happened. This is, they were making the movie, and they told this man, you cannot have lions
this
in your
This is before
house.
He started making the movie.
Oh, wow, this is interesting. Go, carry on.
So he had all these lions in his house, and he said, you can't have those in your house. So so anyway, he had to move all the lions to a nature reserve, which he bought. And he said, I'm going to make a fucking movie. Excuse me. I'm a CEO. I'm not supposed to curse. Don't tell my wife.
Well, I mean...
But
we're all good here. Okay. We can just bleep it out.
So anyway, this guy, he's married to Tippi Hedren from The Birds. From Alfred Hitchcock's The Birds, the actress from The Birds. Another movie about animals attacking people. And Melanie Griffith is Tippi Hedren's daughter, right? She's in the film.
Yes, yeah.
So anyway, the movie is kind of just like this guy has a house and it's filled with lions. There's seriously 100 lions and tigers and giraffes. And they are untrained animals.
Yeah, so all of the animals are untrained.
Yeah.
So all big cats, there's elephants in there too.
There's some elephants.
And so
tigers,
all of them,
panthers, yep. Leopards.
All of them untrained.
It's a veritable circus at this man's home.
Yeah.
So he's like, I'm going to make a movie about this. So they hire a crew or whatever. They shoot this movie. It's called Roar. Now, the plot of the movie is almost irrelevant because they try to get through the scenes and the animals, which are, again, untrained, just do whatever the fuck they want. I'm sorry.
Are these actually the animals? Is it the real animals that the man had inside his house?
Yeah.
So they try to throughout the movie, they try to deliver lines, and as they're delivering lines, they're just getting attacked by lions, pretty
yeah.
much.
Yeah. The movie begins with a title card that says, no animals were harmed in the making of this film. 70 of the cast and crew were. And it is very apparent.
Well,
In virtually every scene, somebody's trying to deliver a line, and then a lion will just fucking jump on him and scratch him. And there's all these scenes with the director is also the main character, and it's him just in his house full of lions.
You know what's funny about that? If it had been the flip flop the other way around, people would have been outraged. But
this is what I'm saying.
Nobody's
about
upset
Holocaust.
About 70 people getting injured.
Yeah, yeah.
Nobody should be because they did this to themselves.
That's awesome.
Yeah, that,
this is what I'm saying about
yeah.
Cannibal Holocaust. Cannibal Holocaust. They're just punching down. They're killing animals for fun. This is about animals beating the shit out of people, and it's fucking awesome to watch. seriously. It is you'll watch it and be like,
who released this? What company is this through?
It wasn't released in America.
It was released in the Europe.
Where did this happen?
It was filmed in California, yeah.
Oh.
They bought a reserve in California. It was released in the United States in 2015. It was released in Europe only in 1981. So it was such a gap. I don't know the reason for it, but there's such a gap between the two in release dates.
They must not have been able
probably
to.
No, that's obviously
to have those
where
there's
I think.
Probably a limitation of
Disregarding our characters, we failed.
Yeah, no,
but,
I was so intrigued at this point that I just dropped the character.
Well, I was going to try and, just explain it as Marcus, but...
It's hard to describe this movie as a character,
yeah,
though, because
it's
so
fucking insane. It sounds like I'm improvising.
Yeah.
It's real.
That's what I thought, yeah, I kind
of... It's fucking insane. Every scene is okay, so there's a part where these guys have to get on a boat and drive somewhere, and the tigers just jump on the boat. They're like, we're coming with you.
It happens twice.
Yeah. And there's like, scenes, like, they're driving along the river, and they're supposed to just make it through the shot, but the tigers fucking tip the boat. Mm-hmm. So it's, like, in the scene, it's clearly unrehearsed. That's how most of the movie is. It's like, the scene is supposed to be going one way, but then the lions are jumping all over people, and they can't do anything. So they just kind of work with it, and like, oh my god.
And there's a certain part where Tippy, Melanie, and then some one other actor was all trapped due to the lions pushing over, like, the furniture, and, like, one of them was in a fridge, and it tipped over the fridge and couldn't get out. One was tipped in a locker. Melanie was trapped in, like, some, like, almost like cabinet, and it's like all these characters are trapped in cabinets based on these lions just being all over the place. They were hiding themselves in rooms and stuff like that because of the lions.
It's like, so like, there's horror movies. This is like a documentary about making a horror movie that is actually scary.
It's a disaster movie.
I know. It's fucking nuts. These people are being... So the cinematographer, Jan de Bont, who directed Speed and shot Die Hard and all this stuff, he was fucking scalped from the back of his head to the, like, to, like, his
temples. Like the front.
Yeah.
It was, like, I think it required, like, over 70 stitches. There's a guy, there's a hunter in the beginning of the film who also gets scalped, and that guy had to have, like, 220 stitches.
Jesus, like, Christ. There's just these random characters in this movie who are just being fucking mauled the on the screen.
The hunters were beaten up the most, and they had the one of the least, like, screen times.
Yeah. Anyway, it's fucking nuts, dude. Like, I was riveted. I think it's a genuinely incredible piece of filmmaking.
Yeah, there's definitely a movie that's never going to be like this again. Like, you cannot make a movie like this ever.
Okay, guys, I got to get out of here. I got to go get, like, 100 lions and tigers. I'm going to go buy a house in California.
Is that Noel?
Yeah, that's just Noel, yeah.
I'll hit you up whenever I'm ready to make a movie about it.
All right.
Later, Noel.
What do you think the nutrition facts are like on this Pelican Bay?
Again, this podcast is brought to you by...
It is premium.
Premium. It's so good, it knocks microphones over.
So, it is, once again, premium hot air popped Pelican Bay white cheddar cheese popcorn.
Pelican Bay.
It's premium, so...
That's what it says.
Yeah, right on the bag.
Naturally flavored.
Whatever that means.
Naturally flavored, I mean... It's flavored by natural causes, being that this artificial salt we threw on it is naturally applied.
Doesn't matter how much salt we put on it, as long as it says naturally flavored is what they would like to say.
So, we talk a lot about movies.
Yeah, we did.
We are recording this on top of a real big fish bandana. That Mr. Dan Stewart, Marcus Theater. It's a ground score. They had a ground score. He found it on the ground at a real big fish show that we went to with the Aquabats.
Yeah, they were there.
It's a pretty good show. It's a great show.
Yeah, it was great.
One of the best shows. One of the best times I've had at a show in a while.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. I liked the... When we saw Aquabats together... 2 years ago? A year and a half ago?
2 years ago. Because I saw them last April is when we flew out for Back to the Beach.
Right. But we saw them last time they were in St. Louis. So.
Right.
But I liked that Aquabats performance way more. They did a lot less skits last time. They did way more skits this time.
See, I like the skits.
I like them, but I just want to hear more music. And when they're doing like this co-headliner spot, it's kind of...
They played for a long time.
Yeah. I mean, Real Big Fish...
I get, like, honestly, nothing... Obviously, nothing will ever top the Back to the Beach set, because I... Because
you were the Pizza Day kid.
...wrote a fucking piece of pizza. No, it was actually during Pool Party. They didn't have time to play Pizza Day. They got bumped by the fucking Boss Tones.
What was the Mighty Mighty Boss Tones going to play? The impression that I get a 100 times?
Which I was pissed about. I'm like, it's one song. It's 3 minutes. We're at a festival. Like, can you fucking... Play the song. What do you mean?
They should have covered Impression That I Get. which is a great song. Actually, that is a fucking good topic. What do you think that song's about? The impression that I get.
The impression that I get. Yeah. No, I was going to say, you said they should cover it. The whole bit that they did. Aquabats and Real Big Fish.
They both covered a lot of songs.
A lot of songs. I just like the Real Big Fish. He was like, way back in the 90s, we wrote a hit song. It was all over the radio. And we're thinking, it's going to be Sellout.
Yeah.
And it was like the big...
Oh, Real Big Fish?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then they started playing Smash Mouth. They played... They did the first verse of All Star, and then they went into Closing Time.
Yeah. What? They also covered Brown Eyed Girl and Take On
Me. Well, those are actually covers of theirs. They have an album with covers.
Oh, yeah.
The Smash Mouth thing was just like...
A bit. But yeah. Aquabats also did covers.
Yeah, they did Pearl Jam...
They did, like, the Arms Wide Open by Creed and Pearl Jam as a bit for a while.
Yeah. Then and they did Journey. They did Fight for Your Right.
They did Where the Streets Have No Name by U2 in the middle of Burger Rain. There was a lot of jokes. I think that's just the ska way. Underneath the ska way. Replacements. Anyway.
This is over.
I also saw snail mail. It's pretty cool.
How do you get snail mail? I feel like snails are pretty slow about delivering mail.
You can get snail mail, it just take a while.
That's the joke, because mail is very slow. This is like a joke from like the 90s.
I thought the joke was that snails are slow and they shouldn't be delivering mail.
Well, yeah, but also that the United States Postal Service mail system is slow, therefore it's akin to a snail.
See, I think that's fucked up, because you go invent a postal service then.
What are you, snail phobic? You snail phobe?
I'm a snail there.
But I saw Snail Mail, the band. It was cool. I had seen so many posts about how she was... not good live, actually. But I wanted to see for myself. Her whole band is also fucking teenagers. They're all teenagers. Which is interesting. It felt a lot like seeing a local band. That's the kind of, like, intimacy that the show brought.
Yeah.
And they played just as much as the opener did. The opener is called Sasami, which I had not heard of, but my brother had. My brother was like, oh, wow, Sasami was there? I was like, whatever. That's my brother for you. He listens to every single band that Pitchfork writes about. Yeah, it was a lot like a local band.
What is it? Was it as bad as what people were saying? Her like performance?
No, it wasn't bad. Her performance was good. The problem was that the venue off Broadway in St. Louis was. Whose website says, committed to being the best venue in... the best sounding venue in St. Louis. That's what their website says.
Yeah.
Is
it best sounding?
Yeah, it said, committed to being the best sounding venue.
Is this off-Broadway?
Yeah. Have you seen shows at off-Broadway?
I've seen quite a few shows at off-Broadway. The last one I saw was Laser Wolf.
Okay, was it the best sounding? We're talking shit on a venue.
Yeah, I'm not going to say shit about talking shit on a venue. I just think that that's a pretty bold claim.
It is a bold claim, but I mean, well, they just said committed to being that, so it means that's they're trying.
That's different. Yeah, they didn't but say like, we are the best.
Yeah, sounding. Exactly. But the fact that, A, the opener was mixed horribly. It was so muddy, which, I mean, the opener is a different story, but like when Snail Mail came up, throughout the first three songs, the whole time she was doing the like, pointing at her guitar and then doing, you know, the finger up, the, like, yeah, turn the guitar
on,
up. Yeah,
in the sound booth.
Yeah, and, like all that stuff. And, like, and then she would, like...
Which I've seen so many shows where that happens, where somebody, like, especially with vocals, they'll, like, point at the microphone and, you know, give the signal, like, I need more in this monitor, and they just never do anything about it. At that point, I feel bad for them. I'm like, man, they came out here to, like, can you be... Do your... You're the sound
guy. Yeah,
yeah, by
your
that
job.
Point, it's like, not the artist's fault at all.
Like, right.
And then, you know, like, in between lyrics, she'd be like, can you turn the guitar up, please? As if, like, they weren't doing it, you know? Like, so I felt bad. And she at one point mentioned, like, yeah, we've been here before. We've played at the old, at Off-Broadway before. And I'm like, clearly they picked this venue because they liked it last time. You know, so it's like, yikes.
Yeah.
Through the first three or four songs, they were... Like, the first song, they had to stop and start over.
I don't think it was necessarily
the mix, but she didn't have... She wasn't, like, prepared. Like, the guitar wasn't plugged in or something.
No.
And it's just like, yikes.
That's embarrassing.
Yeah, it is. And it's like, did you guys not do sound check? I don't know.
practiced?
Well, like, I don't know. They were good, though. Like, they played fine. Yeah, and... Yeah. They didn't do an encore, which was interesting. I mean, they only have one album.
Yeah.
They played for, like, an hour. It was very short.
That's an album. I can't see somebody doing like that necessarily doing an encore, though, even though it was. The only reason why I would think that they would do an encore is because it was a sold-out show.
Yeah, exactly. It was sold out. That was cool, too. I mean, it signaled to me that they should be playing a bigger venue. But also... It's not that hard to take her biggest song, which was her first single from the album Pristine, which everybody in the whole crowd knew the lyrics. That was like she was so overjoyed when she played that song because everybody was so into it, singing it back to her and everything, which it was awesome. It's like just don't play that song, play a filler song from the album in its place and then play that as encore.
That's her encore.
That makes sense to me. Happy, yeah.
Well, everyone knows it, so obviously everyone will get into it and leave happy.
Like, you always feel weird when the set ends and then the house music starts coming up, and you're like, oh.
Oh, that's it?
Oh, that's all they got?
Yeah.
Unless it's, like, John Mouse, who I knew was going to be weird.
Yeah.
That's the only guy I was like, okay, it makes sense that he's not doing an encore.
There's a handful of shows that I can recall to my memory that I remember leaving and being so... Just so happy, like so satisfied with the closer.
Yeah.
You know?
The closer, not the encore.
No, like the closer, encore, whatever the last song that they decided to play.
Okay.
You know, that being like, that was the fucking, that's what we were waiting for, you know?
Yeah. Well, she played her big hit and then she said, okay, the band's gonna go away now, everybody applaud or whatever. She didn't say those words, but that's what the vibe was.
They're going to go away now. Applause.
It's like, all right, thanks to the band or something. And then she's like, I'm just going to play the next one by myself. And it was her just... Only her and the guitar playing the song. And that was the end. Which, like... For me, I like hearing the most popular song and everybody go nuts as the last song.
Yeah.
But I also get the idea of playing the solemn... single.
Right, but that's something you do. That's like a middle of the set. You go, okay, for this next song, and then you do that, and then you play the band back out, and you close big. You
know? Yeah. I don't know. I kind of get it. A lot of my favorite bands do their albums that way, where they, like The National is one of my favorite bands, and one of the on every album, the 9th out of 10 songs
is the one where
you're
in the crowd saying, oh boy, I hope they...
Yeah. Like, yeah. Yeah. They always put, like, in my opinion, they always put the biggest, like,
you said
huge
the best
song.
For last.
Well, they do the 9th out of 10.
You space them out. Yeah, you space them out, and then you do the biggest song last.
Well, I'm saying they're on their albums.
Oh, okay.
They will do their, like, most poignant, crazy song as 9th of 10, and then the 10th one is...
Closer.
Like a solemn, mellow, like, relief.
Okay.
And I think that's... like a fair strategy sometimes. And I think that's kind of what she was doing in her show.
Okay.
It's
different live, though.
It is
it's
different
one
live.
It's thing to make an album. It's a different
to leave everybody hanging on this, like, well, I'm starting to think about life or whatever.
I'm gonna go.
Yeah. But
I gotta go.
Bands playing live. My favorite band.
Oh boy.
Who goes there is playing a show on a day I probably can't go to because I have to work. But
it is a Saturday for you kids with the restaurant gigs, which is most of the people. And am I drinking your? Where did that come from?
That was mine.
Could be anybody.
Unimportant. Sorry, he was plugging the band. Who goes there? What's up?
What's up? It's me. Who?
Speaking of those here, standing manager for Who Goes There. We got a couple good things coming up, and the boys here have been working hard. They just got their album recorded.
I'm going to drop the bit now because I'm actually going to talk about
it. Yeah, this, I was going to say, like, is anybody going to know what the fuck's going on?
No, we just got done recording our album. We still got to do a little bit of mix and master, but this is a huge deal for us. Well over a year now coming up. November, I think, will be 2 years. But, yeah, we got our next show coming up next month, August 17th at Foam with Rad Enhancer and In the Mouth of Radness.
Okay.
It's going to be rad show. I think Dad Jeans also got thrown on the bill there.
Which, what's the date again? Before.
That is August 17th at Foam.
A few weeks.
Yeah, a couple weeks here. Up. A couple weeks out. Looking forward to it. I'm also looking forward to doing a little bit of... Really can't wait to get the album out and then start working on the next one. We've already got a couple songs, single done, and then pressing forward into doing the next album. So, stoked about that. And then might be doing a little scoring for the next feature film of our gracious host, Dan Stewart.
Triplefour Films. Please.
Stay tuned.
I was going to say we should talk about that, but we're at the end here.
Yeah,
we can do another one if you want.
We can do another one.
This is how we end the podcast. Anyway, I just sit here and...
Shout out who goes there. Shout out middle class fashion.
Follow us on Instagram at Who Goes There Official.
That's you being thrown into a deep hole.
That's someone picking you up and just throwing you in there.
Shout out our friends.
Shout out to Foam for having.
Shout out to Foam. Shout out to Sinkhole.
Shout out to Fister. Shout out to Lion's Daughter. Shout out to Path of Might. Shout out to all those rad ass local bands. Hell Knight.
Blackwell.
Dems, my boys. Blackwell. We love you, baby boys.
Inches from Glory.
We love you, Inches from Glory. We love you, Marty. We love you, Kobe. Blake.
Steve Kelly. Camp.
Steve Camp. Shout out Steve Camp. Shout out Two Top. Shout out Moby Thick.
Shout out Lil Parm. Shout out Dirty Henry.
Shout out Charlie. Shout out Kelly. Shout out Baby No Eggs.
Shout out Andy Miami.
Shout out Princess Consuela Banana Hammock. Shout out John the Baptist.
Shout out Larry No Arms. Shout out Tiny shout Tony. Shout out
Freddy Fish Legs.
Shout out Teddy Tubes.
Timmy Tubes?
Shout out Rico Cipino. Shout out Fresh Parm, Lil Pomo, Rico Cipino.
Shout out French Onion.
Shout out Timmy Two Carrots. Shout out
Paddington 2 on Blu-ray.
Shout out to Johnny Onion Rings.
Shout out to Pelican Bay, Hot Air Popped
White Cheddar Cheese, Popcorn.